We continue in this message the subject, Walking Through Open Doors. Open doors to healing, health, prosperity, and victory. Jesus promised in Revelation 3, 7, and 8, These things saith he that is holy, he that is true, he that hath the key of David, he that openeth, and no man shutteth, and shutteth, and no man openeth. I know thy works. Behold, I have set before thee an open door, and no one can shut it. Now, on the authority of the word of Jesus Christ, as we pointed out in the previous message, overcomers have set before them an open door which no one can close, an open door to all the blessings and promises of God, an open door to everything that He's provided for the believer if they will exercise faith and claim it based upon the promises of God. And as we said, everyone seems to know what to do about a closed door with respect to prayer. You're supposed to knock and knock and knock and knock, we're told, to see if it's God's will to open the door. But they seem bewildered and confused when God confronts them with an open door. An open door signifies that you don't have to stand and pound and pound and pound and knock and knock and yell and plead all day to gain entrance. No, an open door is an invitation to walk in. People who don't want anyone to walk in uninvited keep their doors closed. And yet, the way many Christians pray concerning the promises of God, they will pray for weeks and months and sometimes years, begging and pleading and knocking, making the same requests over and over again, why, you would think that God's open doors are in reality closed doors, that the open door that He makes us to all of His glorious promises are really closed, and that perhaps He's just playing cat and mouse with us, that it would be presumptuous on our part simply to do what He says and walk in by faith and begin to enjoy His blessings. And this is why most pray the way they do. God's open doors really seem to be closed to them, and they must knock and knock and ask and beg and plead until they weary God with their prayers. An open door, presumptuous, if you walk through. I remember when I was speaking at a college concerning the charismatic outpouring and sharing how that God had answered the prayer of faith in our church time and time again, and that He teaches us in His Word, for example, in Matthew 21:22, all things whatsoever you ask in prayer, believing you shall receive, and that when you pray, you should believe you have received and you shall have it, Mark 11:24. And then we had a question and answer period after, and I know, for example, that some were really bewildered by such a clear promise of God that He would answer their prayers if they would believe they had received an answer when they prayed. And so one student jumped up and he was all upset and said, why would it be presumptuous to pray and then to say, you know, you have received an answer, to know you're healed, to know that God has answered your prayer? Well, that's presumptuous. He said, that's telling God how to answer your prayers. Oh, no, I said, that's letting God tell you how He wants to answer His prayers. He says He wants to answer your prayers if you will exercise faith and believe. But you see, a lot of people have been taught the wrong things for so many years in their churches that they actually think it's presumptuous to exercise faith when there is but one message in the Bible, and that is faith. I mean, it's faith from salvation in Jesus to everything that God has promised, whatever it may be. An open door presumption? No, an open door is an invitation to enter. Yet the problem with most doesn't seem merely with how to cope with an open door, but it seems their problem is how to get the door open in the first place. Now you will notice there are three conditions set forth in Revelation 3, verse 8 and verse 11, to have an open door set before you. Jesus said, Behold, I have set before thee an open door, and no one can shut it. But what caused this door to be open in the first place? Well, notice verse 8. Because thou hast kept my word. Secondly, because thou hast not denied my name. And then in verse 11, because you have held fast to that which you have. In other words, verse 11, the door will stay open if you hold fast to that which you already have. Now let's look at these three conditions. First of all, he said the door is open if you keep his word. Thou hast kept my word. Now, to keep God's word means only one thing. It means to obey it. And immediately you see the promise of an open door is limited to those who obey Jesus. John 15:7 states the relationship between an open door and obedience to the word of God. He said, if you abide in me, and my word abides in you, then you can ask what you will, and it shall be done for you. Notice the relationship between having an open door to prayer. You shall ask whatever you will, and you'll receive it. Notice that, how it's related to obedience to the word. If my word abides in you, then you can ask what you will. Then the door to prayer is open, and there are no limitations. You see, people who have God's word abiding in them, first of all, can pray the prayer of faith because they know what the will of God is. When you know the word of God, you know his will. And when you know his will, it assumes that you will obey his will before you pray. So often, people we counsel with will ask in a bewildered way, why is there no answer to my prayer? Or why has the money not come that I've prayed for? Or why is it that I'm not healed yet I've prayed? They say, I don't know of any reason. I have faith. Are there really some exceptions to the promises of God? Or where did I miss it, they will ask. And as often as not, I can nail it down to some place where they've not kept the word of God. They've not obeyed the light that God has given them on some matter. They have a wrong attitude towards something or someone. They have unscriptural relationships, perhaps, in their home or their marriage or toward their parents. Or they've got personal sin in their life, an unclean habit or practice. Or they're giving God second place in time, in worship, in study, in allegiance, in their possessions. And so the open door promise is only to those who keep his word, who heed John 15:7. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, you can ask whatever you will, and it shall be done for you. Now we need also to consider that a delay in the manifestation of an answer to prayer may be due either to doubt, or it may be that God wants to mature your faith. But by your questioning God about if it's his will to answer you, or if the answer is going to come, or if this, or if that, by your questioning God, it proves you are not keeping his word on this question. Why? Because Mark 11:24 tells you when you pray, you are to believe you have received when you pray. Hebrews 10:23. Let us hold fast to our confession of faith without doubting, for he is faithful who promised. And so when you question as to whether or not it's God's will to answer you, or whether or not you will receive an answer, or for this reason or that you're raising questions, then you are violating the word of God, the conditions of God for receiving an answer, as we've just shown from Mark 11:24 and Hebrews 10:23. To give an example, there's one individual who has written me several times, and every time I see this person, they're asking the same question, why? Why is my healing not manifested yet? I've prayed, I believe, I'm trying to hold out, but it's so difficult. How long do I have to wait for my manifestation to the healing? Well, there's only one answer to such individuals, and it's the answer I give. It's the only one I can. Faith never questions, it only believes. Faith never questions, it only believes. Faith can't raise a question about the word of God, or it isn't faith. And as long as you're asking why, it's not faith yet. You've not released faith for your healing. Faith is in your head. You do believe in healing, but not in your heart. You know you're healed. You see, faith is heart knowledge. You know a thing is true based upon the word of God. And so such an individual, by raising questions about the word of God, is not keeping his word on the question of healing, as we've shown from Mark 11:24. You are to believe you have received when you pray. So keeping his word on any question concerning the promises of God is to do exactly what he says about it. And what does he say about keeping his word when you pray? He says, when you pray, believe at that moment that you have received and you shall have it. Now, if you believe you have received when you pray, dear friends, you're not going to be asking and asking and asking again for that same request. Again, we're not saying that you should not pray as much as you want about the situation, but ask only once. Let the asking part of your request be made once. Release your faith. Ask God in faith, and then continue to praise God and thank Him as long as you want. So keeping His word involves doing what He says about receiving answers to prayer. He promises an open door to those who abide in His word, who keep His word. Now, so many limit keeping His word simply to studying the Bible, praying, going to church, or not sinning, not doing this or that. But keeping His word on any question, any promise He's made us, with regard to prayer, is to do exactly what He says about it, to meet the conditions. And what does He say about it? Mark 11:24 is another example. When you pray, believe you have received, and you shall have it. We are to believe when we pray. We're not to doubt. Now, God's not talking here to your head when He says to believe you have received when you pray, but to your heart. That's why He says nothing about how you're going to feel immediately after you pray, or a week or a month later, for that matter. Now, we recommend that you expect to feel better after you pray. That isn't what we're saying. But faith is not based upon feeling. Faith is based upon the Word of God. Now, often people will say they believe they're healed after you pray for them, but they prove they really didn't believe it because a day or a week or sometimes a month later, they're still doubting they're healed because they don't feel healed. They say, I don't feel any better, or my symptoms have not left, or I don't see any marked improvement in my condition. And they don't realize that you can't feel healed until first you settle the matter once for all, based upon the Word of God, that you are healed. We must believe what the Word of God says in the faith realm, the invisible realm, before we'll ever see it manifested to our sight. Yes, dear friends, there is a place for believing the Word of God in spite of all evidence to the contrary. We're talking to your heart. The Word of God speaks to your heart. When you pray, believe you have received and you shall have it. God promised Abraham a son, and it was 25 years before the manifestation of that promise was received. Abraham was 100, Sarah was 90, and barren, had never borne a child, and yet they believed that what God had promised he was able to fulfill. They believed God's word in spite of all the medical evidence to the contrary, in spite of what they felt or saw. They believed the word of God, they believed they had received, and they did receive on that basis. Yes, God has opened before us a door. There is an open door to all of His promises. But you notice the condition, first of all, is that we are to keep His word. To keep God's word means only one thing, that is to obey it. And to obey His word means to do what He said about it. And that means when you pray, believe you have received. When you pray, believe, and you shall have it.